And just go back to your point, sir, about Apple Pay. Think about what's happening. Apple Pay was a system by which Apple was initially launching their now Apple credit card, right? Why? Because they had $474 billion in cash. So they thought, hey, I'm going to go ahead and start their own bank. That's how big Apple is. So, you know, eventually they're going to have their own system. They're going to have their own methods, their own encryption, everything else. So, you know, just keep up on top of what's happening. And then if in case you don't understand like what we're trying to tell you as a whole, the whole point of, of what we're trying to tell you is start building walls between you and the outside world, okay? The more walls that there are, the more hurdles other people have to go through, the better it is for you, all right? So obviously, as part of the economic crime unit, I'm being paid by you, okay? So, and so is Detective Verdoni, so is the sergeant, everybody else. You can use us as resources. If you have questions or concerns and you're just like, look, I don't understand what's happening. I get calls every single day. Hey, my son's in jail in Montana and they want us to send a gift card to pay for the bail bondsman or whatever else. You know, and I could just tell you that I don't care what sheriff's office it is, they're not going to accept a gift card, okay? And the same with the IRS. Think about it. The IRS calls you. When have you ever seen the IRS move anything faster than molasses, right? And they're going to send you, and no offense to you know, Special Agent Thompson, but they're going to send you 525 letters first. You're not going to know what's going on. So just step back, use a little common sense, and start building walls. And that's really what we get to. All right. I get asked a lot of times, you know, how does it work and why do we need an economic crime unit? And I just want to spend 1 minute on this. And that is, think about all the law enforcement agencies that I have to deal with on a daily basis just between Manatee, Sarasota, and DeSoto counties. Each one of them has a sheriff's office. Each one of them has a police department. We got Northport, Longboat Key, Sarasota Police Department, Venice Police Department, the airport, the school, right? Everybody's got their own little police department. Now we even got the actual schools that have their own police department, right? Now think about economic crime and what's happening. A 17-year-old kid in Ukraine could be the kid that's actually hacking into your account. So luckily for us, we have a sheriff here and the state attorney thought, okay, we need to start thinking globally, all right? We need to start thinking outside the jurisdictional bounds of the 12th Judicial Circuit, because the vast majority of people that are trying to infiltrate the citizens of Sarasota, Manatee, and DeSoto counties actually come from outside this jurisdiction, right? That makes common sense, everybody. And so we needed some way in order to consolidate all the information that we're getting and have one agency look at it and have one prosecutor assigned to it so we can say, all right, this is worth our time. And just in the last year, you've seen a huge increase in the amount of crime that we're putting out from Miami, from Atlanta, Georgia, from outside our jurisdiction. And I mean, in one case alone was $12 million. This year alone, we've already seized close to $720,000. And this isn't even, January is not even over yet. Okay? And that is the reason why we need these types of things. All right, now as far as today, we're going to talk a little bit about computer fraud, estate hijacking, which is a term that I've tried to make up for several things like romance scams, powers of attorney, and other things like that, and my Ricky Raccoon scams, which are the quick and dirty, you know, $5,000, it's over, is it really worth my time? Now, Ms. O'Neill was very gracious to talk about some of the things that she's talking about on her end as far as the bank, and which I do want to just say one thing quickly is we do appreciate all the civilians that work with us every day. Think about it. In the old days, we had to send a subpoena. It would go to a processing house. The documents would be back, and it would take 30, 40 days in order for us just to find out if you were scammed or not. By her coming to me and saying, hey, these things are happening, we can do it instantaneously, right? Because the money left your account instantaneously. Why does it take me months on end to solve that type of crime? So I just wanted to say thank you. But anyway, you probably remember this, but this is still out there, ladies and gentlemen. These are still happening in various forms. You'll get an email from Bank of America, right? And it looks, everything looks like, this looks pretty official and everything like that, right? But look how it's written. It has come to our attention that your account information needs to be updated due to inactive members, frauds, and spoof reports, okay? So you're like, something's not really 100%, but we'll take a look at it. So you click on it, and look, why is Bank of America coming from a co.uk? Okay, like the very top line, and it looks legit, right? It's red, and you're like, oh, okay, it must be one of those secured things, right? So, okay, that's fine, even if you get past that. Now, wait a minute, you sent this email to me, right? Remember, they sent this email to you. They're the ones that's holding all this information. So why are you giving them your ATM card? Why would they need to know your ATM card? One, why would they need to know your expiration date? Why would you need to know all this information? And why are they asking you for your email address when they're the ones that sent it to you? Right? So people, I'm not talking like 5 people out of 10, you know, 10 or whatever. I'm talking hundreds of thousands of people fell for this scam. And then some people didn't even have a Bank of America account and they were putting this information in. All right? So like the banks that are calling you on that 866 number and you're like, yo, and they're like, hey, this is Regions Bank, blah, 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 and they're talking to you for a half an hour and everything seems fine. And then it's like, hey, I don't have a Regions Bank. Why are they calling me? You know, just step back and take a little bit of time on what's happening. Now, obviously, there's another little thing going on, right? When you're going online and all, you know, some of you guys love the shop online, you like to read articles online, you like to do a lot of things on your phone and all those things like that, you'll start seeing instantaneously, and it's almost scary. I was just doing this the other day. I was looking at a new pair of shoes because my boss was giving me a hard time about my shine. And I said, okay, so I went on and I started looking at shoes, blah, blah, blah. I got caught up with something else. I came back 5 minutes later and boom, the very first commercial, the little very first thing that came on here was about shoes. Isn't that frightening? What has just happened? They've just taken your IP address, they've taken all your information, your browsing history, everything else, and they've already compiled a pattern of what you like. That is then sold to advertising companies. Okay? All your information is gone already. So when you start seeing these things, you need to start saying, okay, I need to start deleting my browser history. And I know it's a giant pain because you're like, oh my God, do I remember my password to, like, you know, cookiemom.com or whatever? And you're like, and I don't want to remember all these passwords again, even though it says save my passwords. It seems every time you do that, it deletes. But you just need to flush it out. You just need to flush these things out all the time. And just think about when you're doing it, okay? When we were talking about, and Ms. O'Neill did a great job, and that is when you're talking about using your debit card versus your credit card, who do you want them to steal, your money or their money? Right? And to answer this young lady's question, like, you don't need to have a credit card per se if you're worried about, look, I got low credit, you know, I don't have a ton of dough. That's fine. Just open up another checking account or open something else different so that card is assigned to somebody else. Okay? So, you know, so that the maximum amount of money that you're losing is tied to a definite dollar amount. You know what I mean? I say use a credit card everywhere outside, right? I don't, ATM machine is for debit cards. Everything else is a credit card, period. Gas stations especially, right?
Even gas stations and so forth, you can check credit in those debit cards.
Right, I understand that. Right, exactly. Do not use, again, do not use your debit card anywhere outside of you taking cash money, period, end. Period. period. Right? Think of it in this way. Your kid uses your phone to buy all those games, right? And these games are from China. Well, congratulations, you just bought those mystery tokens using your debit card in a place in China. If you, it's like, would you give that your debit card to a guy on the street in Brooklyn, New York? Because that's what you just did. Okay? Don't do it. It's your money. Let them steal the bank's money. You know what I mean? Heck with that. You cut up the card, you throw it away, they're going to be more than happy to send you one in about 5 minutes because they want you to keep spending. Plus, you don't get miles and everything else. And then as far as the other lady's question, hey, well, why do I keep this money? Where do I put my account? You're going to put your money in the thing that has the most interest, period. Right? And then your checking account gets 0.00029. Well, why are you keeping your bulk of your money in a 0.00029 interest rate? Your money should be going in somewhere that's getting the highest interest rate, period, end of story. Right? I mean, this is real, real. You guys got to think. Compartmentalize. Think about it. Everybody else is diseased but me. These are those like monsters on TV coming after you. That's exactly what's happening, honestly.
My grandson now has an account, his debit card. He likes Apple. He likes to go and buy stuff. Now, his mother doesn't keep real tight reins on it.
Yeah.
Because he's a teenager But he could get into trouble,
couldn't he? Well, you just think, if he's doing Apple Pay through a credit card, through another thing, that's two layers he's put between him and his money. Let him spend his money, but you know, just think of how many layers you're doing. We're going to answer all like most of your questions at the end because Detective Verdoni is probably going to get a million questions too. But here's some other common reverse social engineering. Reverse engineering, all that means is that they're taking basic biographical information for you so that they can talk to you on the phone intelligently. Who's Aunt Sally? Who's this? Who's that? You know, who are you, period? Like in that you belong to the Veterans Club of America or your good mom's Girl Scout XYZ person or ASPCA, whatever. Think about this. When you go to Bass Pro Shops, is a famous one for this, sign here to win a free blank, right? You go in there and then you sign that card, they get your email, they get your address, they got your phone, they got your age, they got who you are, they got how much money you make per year. Now think about it, you lose your social security number, you go online or you go to your credit accounts, those are all information that these people are gonna be asking you. Your dog Bambi, they're gonna know about that. So why are you writing and giving it to some mystery human being so that you can win a trip to Alaska for 10 days, blah, 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 if we draw your name? Everybody here who's won those trips, raise your hand. You won a trip to Alaska. Okay.
Well, they always call you, say you have to do such and such to get.
Right, no one's ever won those, ever, right? They just took all that information and sold it to somebody else. Okay, using Friendster and other social, right, they look at it, they use Ancestry.com, they try to find out. You can literally use this just by typing in names, right, because Ancestry wants to reel you in. So they're like, you type in my name, Van Sickle, blah, blah, blah. And you find out, oh, look at that guy's dad and this and that and blah, blah, blah. Well, now we've already known who everything is. I can go onto Facebook and start talking to you. So when you use the grandma scam, I can say, yeah, Aunt Sally, you know, told me to talk to you. Well, she never goes by Aunt Sally. She always goes by Frickleschnitz or whatever. You know what I mean? And so you just have to be thinking, okay, other people have more information that's readily available. They catch you off guard. Just take a moment and be like, look, let me call Frickleschnitz and make sure that you're really in jail. Right? You're not going anywhere. The jail is fine for you. You're going to get a sandwich. Relax. Okay? Romance scams and durable powers of attorney. Now, I deal with exploitation cases all the time, okay? And exploitation cases just means that you're in a position of trust. You trusted somebody and they took advantage of you at some point in time later on. Now, a lot of you are trying to think, and you're doing it very wisely, thinking, look, this is the fall slash winter of my life, and I'm trying to make preparations for the future. What happens if I trip, I fall down, I break my hip, right? What's gonna happen to Skippy, right, my cat? Or how is my bills gonna be paid, and those types of things. So you're thinking, I need to start thinking estate planning, all right? Now, I wanna be very delicate with this because it always raises a lot of questions, but yesterday was our dog sounding. I literally prosecuted someone's son whose dad was living in a facility and was counting on his own son to manage his affairs while he now is incompetent, all right? Guess what? His son blew through all the cash and the facility threw the guy out, okay? And so these types of things happen all the time. So what do we do about it? All right. You guys we have the highest percentage of seniors here in the state of Florida, right? We don't have the highest number, California does, but we have the highest percentage of seniors per person. You guys are gonna leave to me, the baby boomers are gonna leave to me $30 trillion, okay? Thank you, and my address was right on the front. So if you guys don't have anyone, give it to me. All right, now think about this also. Because of medicine, the managed care time has increased by 10 years over the last 20 years. That means your life expectancy or the time that you are going to be under care just increased 10 years. So if you are thinking estate planning, you have to think of the next more than 10 years. Who remembers this guy? Mr. Marshall, right? And Miss Nicole Smith, right? He was 89 years old. You subtract 26 off of that, plus 2 years of marriage, equals $474 million that she tried to take, right? What happened later is you got 24 lawyers, $2.7 million later, 20 years it's been sitting in court, 20 years, and not a single dollar has been dispensed to anybody in the family because all that money's been tied up, all right? That's the type of things that we're trying to prevent you from making those mistakes. Now look, he's looking pretty happy though. All right? But just remember, as far as romance scams are concerned, there's a lot of websites, GoFish, you got all these Christian dating websites and all those things like that, right? But just last year, we dealt with a case where, you know, this young man, we'll just say, was dealing with someone overseas and was thinking, okay, I'm gonna bring her over and I'm gonna do all these things for her and help her child out, you know, and it's a Russian type of thing. And so it started off slowly with like, can you send me a phone? Can you send me this money? Can you do this? Can you do that? And the next thing you know, we're talking $40,000-$50,000. Now, as it turns out, he was actually talking to a 16-year-old boy. Okay? And so, you know, you just need to stop. And it's just, okay, if they don't know who Humphrey Bogart was or whoever your favorite person was and your band and the Beatles and the things that you like, and they're like, oh, I've never heard of this and blah, blah, blah. Well, the person was getting away with it on the other end because, oh, I'm Russian, you know? So like, I don't know. Well, you know what? Let's do a face-to-face first before I start doing those things. Okay, gaining the power of attorney, which is the most frightening part of this whole lecture that I think that you guys are gonna deal with. A power of attorney, functionally in the state of Florida, is two things you have to remember. One, you don't need to be a licensed person to be the attorney in fact, okay? There is no license. All right, that means that anybody that you want to designate can functionally become you. That's what happens. A durable power of attorney, which a lot of people mistake, does not survive after your death. Once you're dead, that's it. okay? Durable means after you've lost incompetence. Like you become incompetent for some reason, like you're sick, you're frail, you're mentally you checked out, whatever. That's what durable means.
Okay.
We're going to ask some questions, but is it like quick?
Yeah, you're saying that a power of attorney is when you're alive. A durable power of attorney is when you're dead. It takes over.
No.
The
power of attorney can be used at any time. When you sign it when you go down to buy a car, and they have a little power of attorney for a specific reason of getting your new tag, right? Mm-hmm. So you're giving them the power to act in your stead of you having to go down to the tag office, right? But power of attorneys that people sign here are these giant documents that give these people power to do everything, manage your accounts, pay your bills, take care of Skippy, do everything, right? And then they're online and you buy them for like $3.99, and they're just these overwhelming documents that basically functionally that person became you. They could sell your real estate out from underneath you without your authority.
And you call that regular power of attorney?
That regular everyday power of attorney. I'm saying like it all encompassing.
Okay.
Durable just means that it means after you've become incompetent or whatever else, it survives up until your death.
Okay, I thought I misheard it.
All right? All right, now think. This is a quote that I got off the top thing. I typed in Florida durable power of attorney, okay? And the very first thing that came up in the top left-hand corner in Google search, drafting a durable power of attorney is an act of love, is it? By detailing how you want matters regarding your health and your finances handled in the event of emergency, you're sparing your family and your friends the unpleasant task of making such decisions in a stressful time. If you suffered a serious injury, leaving you in a coma, for example, these legal documents would allow your loved ones to handle your financial affairs and your absence and make crucial health care decisions in such as life support. Okay, well, we're going to talk about how that goes, but you're going to get a health care surrogate and everything else. We're going to forget the minutia of the documents. But the fact of the matter is would you want someone to be in charge of the plug and your money? Okay, so just think about when you're doing life estate, all right, and you're thinking power of attorney, and you're thinking, you know what, my kid Joey, he's a lawyer now, he's got his relative act pretty much together and those types of things, and I want to make him my power of attorney just in case something happens. Now, I don't know Joey. Your lawyer doesn't know Joey. Only person that knows Joey is you, right? You've known Joey since he was a child, and you know the minute he ever had a dollar in his pocket, he was blowing it on his girlfriend, right? You know Joey drives a Porsche. You know that he's the one that's outspending his money. Yes, he's a lawyer, or yes, he's a doctor, or yes, whatever, but the fact of the matter is you know Joey. Joey is not going to change from a mouse to a cat, you know what I mean? And whatever else that you're thinking. So if you're worried about making these decisions and you're thinking, okay, I want to make Joey my POA, which I deal with this all the time when I'm telling you this, is just give him training wheels. Give him a limited power of attorney, limited. Meaning, I want you to take care of my money while I still got my marbles, and I want you to pay the Comcast bill. I want you to pay my rent. I want you to do these things for me while I can supervise you, okay? And giving them the limited power of attorney, maybe just on one bank account, okay? But not your finance, not your investments, for example, okay? That's the type of thing that you got to just make decisions on that are wise decisions, okay? I deal with, and I have prosecuted in the last year, caretakers, which are famous CNAs or non-licensed people that come in and change your diapers, come in and take your money, right? And they say, oh, it's a gift. We're dealing with a case with that right now that was in the newspaper recently, okay? Family members, my son Joey took all my money. Concerned neighbors, all of a sudden you're sick and the guy next door is mowing your lawn after 20 years of living next door. real motivation equals your cash, right? Attorneys, sorry, it's true about what they say about us, okay? I've even had doctors and clergy members, you know, they just, sometimes they see the big dollar amounts. That's your life money that you've saved all your life for. They didn't save for it, so it starts off real slow. Starts off with, you know, I took your credit card to go down and get you diapers or get down, you know, get you food or whatever it is. And then, oh, I needed a television set or whatever, and I'll pay her back. And then it'll start off real slow, but then eventually it starts getting bigger and bigger and bigger until there's no more money. Okay? So, in fact, remember just this one thing, durable power of attorney is a license to steal from you. So be careful of who you give it to. All right, the last couple of things I just want to hit real quick before I turn things over to the detective is guaranteed for life annuities, all right? Tom Selleck, whoever, you know, reverse mortgage, all these people are coming on TV nowadays telling you that there's these guaranteed for life annuities, all right? One, no one should be knocking on your door selling you an annuity, period. Okay, it takes a Series 7 license or an insurance, it's an insurance license to be able to sell an annuity in the state of Florida, okay? So no one should be knocking on your door, okay? And you think I'm laughing, but these people literally sit at your kitchen table and you're handing them $50,000 in cash, you know, where they write a check, right, to these annuities because they're guaranteed for life income. I'm not saying all annuities are bad. What I'm saying is just be careful of what you're buying, and no one should be knocking on your door selling you an annuity. They have to have a license to be doing it, and if someone could exchange stock on the New York Stock Exchange with the Series 7, they're not going to waste their time sitting knocking on your door, okay? So the fact of the matter is just be careful with these lifetime annuities, all right? Most of the time, just think of it, and all an annuity is a bet that you're going to die before the money runs out, okay? And then you take your money plus 5% interest or 3% interest or whatever you're doing, right? The amount of money, $50,000, let's just call it. $50,000 at 3%, you divide that by 12, by 20 years, right? And if that money, if that number is less than, if it's more than the number that you're going to be getting back over a period of time, then you keep your money, period. Does that make sense? $50,000, which is your initial payment, they're promising you $225 each month for the rest of your life. If you take that number and you divide it by 20, by 20, 12, right, the same amount, and that your number is bigger, you've just wasted your money. All right? The telephone is marketing scams, the detective's all over that. He's got it. The contract fraud. I gave you guys pieces of paper, which you can, I go around in my shorts and my tennis shoes and I put them in your mailboxes all the time. I try. Please, if you could do me just one favor and hire people who are licensed, I would be ever so grateful because it eliminates 50% of what I do for a living and I can concentrate on other things. I understand that a lot of you guys come from New Jersey, New York, wherever, where you don't need licenses to do all these things. In the state of Florida, you need a license to do just about anything that's more than $500, even if it's putting in a sink, a fan in, anything that a third party has to do. I understand that you do it yourself, right, and that's allowed. But if you're gonna hire somebody, that person's gotta be licensed to fix your fan. That person has to be licensed to fix your plumbing. And those types of things for a reason. The reason is that we just have too many handy men who come in, give you, and rip you off. They don't have the business skills to manage large amounts of money. Right? If it costs more than $50, my general rule is this. If it costs more than $50 to do whatever job that it is, hire someone that's professional, period. And when I mean professional, I mean licensed through Deeper. I don't mean the kid that's going to come over and mow your yard for 10 bucks, right? Who cares if he's licensed? I don't care about the guy who's going to weed. I don't care about the guy who's going to power wash your driveway. I care about anybody that physically walks inside your house who could be a sex offender, who we caught on the last sting, right? Or a convicted felon who claims to be a handyman and busting out your walls. All right? So please, take what I gave you to heart. You got the website, takes 5 seconds. I talk to all of the contractors in Sarasota County every third Wednesday of every single month, and they will be more than happy to show you their license. Trust me, it's not an insult.